It's really my great pleasure to be introducing Alexei Ksakhnin. For somebody relatively young, he has a biography most of us would envy. He is a historian, but in two quite distinct ways. First, he writes about history, but he also tries to make it. The doctoral dissertation he wrote at the Russian Academy of Sciences focused on the debates about the Soviets within the Bolshevik Party. It came out in 2017 under the title The Experience of October, How to Make Revolution. Plenty of useful tips there for those interested. Although he would be the first one to tell you, his sympathies were really always with the socialist revolutionaries, the SRA. Alexei's second book, The Bolotnaya Revolution, deals with the 2011-2013 mass protest movement in Russia and the role of the left in it. He saw these protests from multiple points of view, from the street, on the stage, and from inside the coordinating council of the opposition, alongside Alexei Navalny, Boris Nemtsov, and Sergei Udaltsov, and other leaders of the opposition. Following the notorious May 6th court case, as many of the opposition's leaders, including some of his closest comrades, were being arrested and prosecuted, he escaped to Sweden, where he spent the next 6 years writing and doing various odd jobs, such as working on a ship. He has since returned to Russia, where he is now an activist for the Left Front and works as a journalist. I would really wholeheartedly recommend his articles in Moskvich Mag. I've rarely met Russian speakers and writers with such vivid imagery. So really, you're in for a treat. Alexei will spend the next hour lecturing, and we'll have half an hour, however long it takes, with questions and answers. Over to you, Alexei.
Yes, thank you very much, Rosen and Alexandra and Jordan Center for inviting me here and the opportunity to discuss that interesting issue. As you probably know, that's a quite turbulent time now in Russia. A big protest took place for some weeks ago, and illegal demonstration would happen tomorrow, organized by Communist Party and the coalition of so-called left patriotic forces. So authorities are quite scaring, and as usually they are trying to skip the public attention from the politics into the historical questions. Now they promise us kind of city referendum in Moscow with the question if it is necessary to restore the monument to the Iron Felix, to Dzerzhinsky, the founder of Soviet intelligence service, in the front of KGB building. And all the civil society now discussing this actual question instead of discussing protests and actual politics. So you can see that it's quite actual questions in Russia. You know, even market economy in its Russian form react on that agenda. And today I bought such a nice souvenir. It's a candle in form of Dzerzhinsky head. So let's try to understand together what does it mean, all that strange agenda. And I was stressed for a while and thinking how to begin this presentation. And suddenly I understand that there is a guy, you can see him on your screens, who can probably assist me to clarify some of my points. I hope it would be a win-win situation, because surely American public knows who him is. And he's, as far as I know at least, is not this much Russian, but in some perspective, he's also could be described as a victim of the class inequality. He's probably not this much read, but probably partly a bit Brown. So we look on him, and then we can look on other picture where is Congress of the so-called People's Movement, the Russian Way, or in some translation, the Russian Order, probably. Joke is that movement was created by the Communist Party something like 15 years ago, and all the leadership of the Communist Party stay behind and singing that nice song in this ancient Slavic paganist decorations. So that symbolic parallels, we can leave the symbolic parallels and look on what ideologists and intellectuals are saying. I hope you know who is this guy who is speaking about fight against a new liberal policy in with coalition of working class and middle class of America. And on the next picture is one of the former leaders of the Communist Party, the founder of the Russian Order, the Russian Way, that movement which we discussed just now. And it would be easy if you would just read his speech in my translation, then I would repeat him. But in any case, you can see that agenda is quite similar. So we can say that it's that Russian phenomenon is one in a line in some international, wide international context. And then, as far as I am historian, no. Before history, let I tell you about my personal experience. When I was a child, the red and brown for me was not, and for my generation, and I guess not only for my generation, for younger generation as well, red and brown was not a just intellectual stream like Steve Bannon on Fox News. It was a real huge, many millions mass movement, which you can see almost every day on the streets. And it was one of two poles in society, the liberal top and that red-brown environment, red-brown, let's say, religion in the down. And that two poles was sites everyone have to self-determine himself, self-identify himself before one became left or right, conservative, liberal, or socialist. He should react somehow on these two real forces and two real poles of society. And you have not to be kind of analytic or expert to summarize the ideology, the main theses of that red and brown religion. It was quite objective. It was very strong anti-elite populism within that framework of people against the government, or sometimes people against the rich oligarchs. It was complete rejection and distrust to the West. Everything what is coming from West, from music to fashion and from art to sexual attitude, sexual freedom, is absolute evil. Then patriotism and sometimes xenophobia of different degrees. Most often it was anti-Semitism, but sometimes also hostility towards migrants, Muslims, people from Caucasus, and we can say that is a brown aspect. The same time, with the same energy, it was values of equality and social justice, let's say red aspect. But the lost social equality perceived not as a right which could be won or defended, but as a gift taken away. And from that perspective, it was a very natural cult of the state and state paternalism. Since in 90s, state and government was on the other side, this situation reflected as a problem of temporary occupied motherland, And you can choose who is the main occupier. Oligarchs, Americans, or Jews, probably. And finally, it was clean anti-democratism as a value. There is still exist a term and ideological cliche, which sounds as дерьмократы, дерьмократы in Russian, which is a game of words, shit and Democrats. And finally, of course, it's a conspiracy of all levels and all forms, as you can imagine. And now let's start from the roots and history, how two antipodes, communism and hardcore nationalism, met. I will try to make it briefly in order to concentrate on the contemporary issues in contemporary history. But first time, Soviet communism had a remarkable flirt with right-wing nationalism already in the 20s. Just a few years after the Russian Revolution, one of the leaders of the Communist Party, of the Bolshevik Party, the future ally of Leo Trotsky and the future victim of Stalin repressions, Karl Radek, who was one of the leaders, one of the chiefs of the Communist International, had a quite famous speech about the far-right German activist Leo Schlageter. Leo Schlageter was a kind of partisan nationalistic hero in the Western Germany. He was sentenced to death and shot by a French occupational army. And that case had a huge resonance in media, in society. And then Bolsheviks tried to integrate that energy of radical right nationalism into the international strategy of the Communist International. You can read the quotation from Radek's speech. That didn't work in the 20s in Germany and in the First World, let's say, in general, but many times used as a tactics and strategy in the Third World, in colonial world, where local nationalists collaborated with communists on the anti-imperialistic platform. But from the other side of the political spectrum, there was also move toward to from right side, there was move toward recognition of the communism, of the Soviet communism. And the key person in that context could be Nikolai Ustryalov, quite famous right-wing politician. He was, before revolution, he was member of right-wing, liberal, and partly nationalistic Constitutional Democratic Party. And then was very active inside the white movement during the Civil War. He was a kind of governmental expert in Kolchak military government in Siberia. And then emigrated. And in immigration, he became a main ideologist and main figure in the intellectual movement, which is famous under the brand Millstone Changes. He described the Soviet state, the Soviet Union, as a new form of Russian imperial statehood. He compared it with radish, which is red only outside, but white inside. And he was heard and recognized in Soviet Union. Stalin commented his theory. Stalin was not afraid of Thermidor, of party metamorphosis, of transformation of the communism into the new form of nationalism, but still he knew who was it. And that kind of flirt, that kind of friendship between right nationalism, traditional Russian nationalism and communism played some role until the mid of 30s, but coming war, made the flirt with nationalism deathly dangerous in the USSR. Industrial was sentenced to death and shot it the same year as Karl Radek. But war, which began 4 years later, turned situations once again. Let me come to the next slide. It turned situation once again because just survival of socialism and social state and the national self-preservation of the Russian people coincided. And that means that patriotism returned to their official propaganda. War itself was called and called until now as a great patriotic war. And all Russian, all Soviet art, the poetry and cinema turned to the images of national heroes, heroes of the national resistance against the conquerors. We can remind, for example, the famous Eisenstein film, Ivan the Terrible, who created the conception of the progressive Tsars. So the communist official propaganda recognized that the war progressive side in that social and political order, pre-revolutionary social and political order. And 1944, Stalin returned the officer ranks into army, similar to the Tsarist army ranks. Then 1943, Stalin restored the Russian Orthodox Church hierarchy, and church became the church as a holder of the keeper of the conservative version of national tradition, became the younger ally of the Soviet power. And the final point was a famous Stalin toast, which he raised in late May 1945 in the name and the health of the Russian people. You see here the quotation, which is still very popular and quotes all the time in all form of, in many communist demonstrations or meetings. And then war finished, but almost directly it's changed into the regime of the Cold War, when the main enemy became former West allies. And confrontation with them led Soviet leadership to fight the sympathies and pro-Western feelings and sympathies inside the society. In practice, that led them to establish a few anti-cosmopolitan campaigns, which finished with quite bloody repressions. And when there was created Israel state, and when it turned on the Western side of the Cold War, Soviet communist regime started a few anti-Semitic campaigns. One of them is quite famous in West as a Night of the Murdered Poets. It was a criminal case against the Jewish Anti-Fascist Committee, finished in 52 with the shooting of a few Jewish Soviet intellectuals. Such anti-Semitism was also incorporated in official ideology in moderate form as anti-Zionism. Then Stalin died, and in the late Soviet, he transformed to a quite popular image, especially among the regular people. On official level, after 1956, after the 20th Party's Congress, he was almost not forbidden, but forgotten. But the usual people use his image. For example, there was a kind of mass symbolic movement where when the drivers of cars and buses put his Stalin's portrait under the переднее стекло.
Window shield.
Window shields, right. But you know, the same time, it was a time when the influence of official propaganda get much less, and Stalin image coexisted with the traditional prejudice of the people of the working class, together with anti-Semitism and all other prejudice. But that was not this much important as what was going on the top of society. And there in '60s, were created kind of informal circles of, let's say, nativist intellectuals. They unite around the magazine Young Guard, which had almost a million copies in '60s and '70s. And there was a group of writers who wrote the village prose with such kind of nostalgia about the peasantry past of the Russian people, with nostalgia about traditional culture and orthodoxy and so on. And that kind of intellectuals were in permanent communications with a part of communist nomenclature. Inside the party existed kind of informal network, which is famous under the brand the Russian Party. It was powerful bureaucrats like KGB leader Shelepin in the late '60s, like the Leonid Brezhnev daughter, who supported that side of the that form of interpretation of communism in terms of Soviet patriotism. And already in 1965, there were created organization which called All Union Society for Protection of the Historical and Cultural Monuments, ВНИИПИК in Russian. And it was indeed the first legal nationalistic organization. In 1980, the radical part of that organization split into the new informal society, which called PAMYATI, the memory, which was more or less National Bolshevik Party of the early 80s. The leader of memory, Vasilyev, he liked to quote the early Marx article about Jewish question, you know. And in such composition, all that came to the perestroika time, which changed everything. Because all circles and all networks of intellectuals very fast transformed into the movements. And nationalists were the first one, at least the first oppositional mass demonstration after 60 years, after Leo Trotsky's demonstration of 1927, had happened in May 1987 and was organized by Society PAMYATI. That time it was not openly anti-communist, but very fast it evolutionated from that kind of Soviet heart, Soviet patriotism to the clean white Russian conservatism, monarchism, and anti-Semitic nationalism. Already in 89, it became the clean right-wing nationalist organization. Very similar thing happened with almost all circles and networks. There were democratic socialists, there were pro-West liberals, and just loyalists were the last force in society which was not mobilized in some autonomous zone, just because there was no need in such kind of mobilization for the loyal citizens of the Soviet Union. For them, it still exists a communist official ideology, which was enough for conformist adaptation and for like demonstration of your loyalty, demonstration of your ideological views. So they were the last not mobilized force in society. And the first attempt to formalize the platform for mobilization of pro-communist, pro-Soviet patriots, pro-Soviet even nationalists, took place just in 1990. And it was quite important case. It was the attempt, and successful attempt, to create the Communist Party of the Russian Federation, of the Russian Soviet Federative Socialist Republic. You know that in Soviet Union, there was a Communist Party of the Soviet Union, and communist parties in each republic, except the biggest one, except Russia. So in 1990, the group of communist leaders and nomenclature bureaucrats created with such pro-Soviet nationalistic and patriotic views and rhetorics, they created the Communist Party of Russian Federation, Russian Soviet Federation, as a tool, as a platform to fight the Gorbachev's course, which they start to recognize as a dangerous for the Soviet Union, for the unity of the country. And it was one of the cases which Marx called the irony of the history, because still they created that Communist Party of the Soviet Union that destroyed the communists' vertical of power. It destroyed their administrative vertical, administrative tools of the top leadership to rule the country. Gorbachev appears suddenly in an empty sphere. That's why pro-Soviet loyalists, pro-Soviet patriots, was one of the main forces which destroyed the Soviet Union. And we're in that point coming to the contemporary history, to the modern history, which was declared in the theme of the discussion. So still Soviet Union existed. That national communism was not necessary. All who loved Soviet Union just sit home and connected all those hopes with the leadership, as they did always for all the Soviet 70 years. But then suddenly, after the August coup of 1991, when the attempt to restore communist authoritarian regime collapsed and power transferred to Boris Yeltsin, to the Russian president Boris Yeltsin, he forbid the Communist Party. And suddenly appears that that there is no one who can lead Soviet loyalists. Some months it seems that there is no one who like the Soviet order, social and political order. But already in November 1991, it was a huge shock for society, because on the anniversary of October Revolution, probably hundreds of thousands of people came to the central squares of the cities to celebrate it. And it was strange because, look, for 70 years, it was bureaucrats who organized all the demonstrations. They just mobilize workers from industrial enterprises or budget workers involuntarily to participate in such demonstrations. And now there is nobody who organizes, nobody who calls an order to come tomorrow to demonstration. And suddenly, without any organization, spontaneously, thousands of people came to demonstration with red flags and all Soviet portraits from Lenin to Gorbachev. That was a shock. It shows that there are people in country who still love the Soviet Union, and there are a lot of them. But probably we could not say that it was the birthday of the red and brown movement and red and brown ideology. If we will take a look on chronics and listen voices of participants of that demonstration, you would be surprised. They repeat once and again the main ideological narrative of perestroika, the democracy. They were angry that their voice now is forbidden. And those main demand was just representation, just return us to the public sphere. And there was all possible forms of voices and narrative in framework of the socialist ideology, the official Soviet Marxism. But then what happened then? The 25th of December 91, the red flag of the Kremlin was lowered, and Gorbachev handed over power to Boris Yeltsin. The Union of the Soviet Socialist Republic ceased to exist. And from the 1st January 1992, in Russia start the radical market reform, shock therapy. You know, I remember that January of 1992. I was 10 years old. My parents, they are pediatrists. We have Eastern European level of consumption of life. Once a year, traveled somewhere on the Black Sea coast. And then suddenly, during 1 month, the salary of my parents have depreciated as much that it become equal to the one pack of the chewing gum. So the welfare state disappeared during 1 month. And that in streets suddenly appears thousands of homeless people. We never saw them before. First time for decades after the war appears thousands of people who had no enough food. And that social collapse happened together with the collapse, disorganization of the great empire, of the great state. George Bush, that older one, congratulate Americans with the victory in the Cold War. And for Russians, for people here, geopolitical defeat means at the same time poverty and the crash of the social order in general. And that happened not on the battlefield. The causer of both tragedies was our own leadership. And that creates the conditions where born the culture, where national and social resistance were inseparable. That create conditions for the born of the red and brown. And red and brown had took birth. It we can say the day when it had happened, probably. Tomorrow will be 29 years of the day. It was 23rd of February 1992. 23rd of February is a day of the Red Army, the Soviet Army. And it's day when veterans and officers and in general, all men are going to the eternal flame and put flowers in the memory of the heroes of the war, of the wars, all wars. And it happened the 23rd February 1992. But the new authorities, which call themselves Democrats, which legitimated those rule with war democracy, they forbid that huge demonstration. And when it happened, they ordered to police, to the riot police, just to beat people. And between people, the majority of that people, they were veterans, you know, many veterans of the Great Patriotic War, the old people. And that humiliation, becomes the glue which unite the national feeling with memory about communism. But then, you know, to understand how the red and brown identity appears and was created, we should take in focus that when people speak about Gorbachev perestroika and Yeltsin's transformation, Yeltsin's reforms, people in the West often perceive them as a introduction of the freedom of speech. Indeed, that was not the truth. Indeed, the freedom of speech of this time means just freedom to scold communism. Just the huge propagandistic apparatus, which for decades brand imperialism, turned over for 180 degrees and started attack communism. The same people, the same journalists, and the same media start to do it in a way they were very experienced in. Like the main ideological cliche of the Soviet propaganda was, of course, the main negative ideological cliche of the Soviet propaganda was, of course, fascism, and was used in context of American imperialism, the reaction. And now, liberal journalists in all medias, in TV and newspapers, just to add that ideological cliche, fascism, together with communism. There was a famous Democrat, famous liberal politician, Evgeny Proshichkin, the chief of the Moscow Anti-Fascist Committee, who created that term, the red and brown. And his partner, famous publicist and intellectual, one of ideologists of the liberal transformation, Valeria Novodvorskaya, she transformed it into even more ugly one, the Comuna fascism, the communist fascism. And all that ideological cliche start to be repeated every day. The media talk all the days about the gangs of national communist pogromists, although not a single store was looted. When in 93, the left forces got a lot of voices in elections, Valeria Novodvorskaya wrote, I want just to quote to let you understand the level of that propagandistic hysteric. She wrote that Russia, having received freedom, choose evil because it consonant with its own nature. And such ideological pressure continues the decade, all 90s. In 1997, when there was next elections and the main opponent of unpopular President Boris Yeltsin was the leader of the Communist Party, Gennady Zyuganov, there was the liberal journalist on the governmental money with 20 million copies, print the newspaper, God forbid. And all that newspaper was dedicated to the phobia that if communists will return, it would be massacre. It would be new gulag and new massive repressions. And after years, months and years of such propagandistic pressure, it creates the effect that movement itself start to recognize itself as a red-brown one. In logic, you know, if you are so afraid of red-brownism, then we will be red and brown. And it was intellectuals who declared that transformation. It was famous writer Eduard Limonov, who in 1993 created the National Bolshevik Party. You see on your screens the demonstration of that party. And he wrote in declaration, what is National Bolshevism? The fusion of the most radical form of social resistance and the most radical forms of the national resistance is National Bolshevism. The other famous intellectual, the chief editor of the main oppositional newspaper, the almost only one big oppositional newspaper, Alexander Prokhanov, wrote a novel which called The Red and Brown, where he recognized himself and his ideology and recognized that identity, the red and brown. The culmination of the resistance against the new liberal reforms of Boris Yeltsin's administration, the war confrontation between the Yeltsin's administration and the Supreme Soviet, the Russia's parliament. And in 1993, the world, hundreds and thousands of people unite around the parliament. You see the building of parliament in October days of 1993. And for some weeks, there were permanent demonstrations with hundreds of thousands of people around it who tried to defend the constitution and the constitutional order. Indeed, there was a quite wide coalition. Around White House, as we call that building, there were all oppositional organizations. There were anarchists there, anarchist barricade, and there were hardcore nationalists there on other side of the square. And all radical communist organization, of course, were there, except one. Authorities understood that huge discontent against those transformations, those reforms, need to create a channel to canalize all that discontent, all that protest energy into a control track. And authorities gave the party license to create restore the Communist Party to the quite moderate leaders of the former Communist Party of the Russian Soviet Federal Socialist Republic, led by Gennady Zyuganov. And that moderate Communist Party, which is the main Communist Party until today, it was the only one who got place in the state television in the days of the coup in 1993, in order to call the supporters of the Communist Party to stay home. We should stay home now and keep the party for some future issues, said Gennady Zyuganov. And at the same time, all other speakers in TV and, of course, other media, they directly called to the military coup. There is a famous speech of the Lia Hijakova, the famous actress, who 2 days before the coup said in television, "What is this damned constitution? I don't know what will happen now if the hundreds, thousands of people supporting parliament right now. Where is our army?" asked she. "Why doesn't army protect us from this damned constitution?" And next day, army came into the city, shut the parliament. All leaders of resistance were arrested. Few hundreds of people were killed, of course, in the name of democracy. And all Western leaders, from Bill Clinton to Helmut Kohl, supported Yeltsin in the name of democracy. Thus, democracy for decades became the dirty word for million people from working class and the poor part of society. And what did happen then? So the monopoly on the discontent, on the protest movements, was concentrated in the hands of the moderate Communist Party. And the Communist Party, that Communist Party, was not just casual union of left-wing people or even Soviet patriots or something like this. No, it have very clean social basis. In Russian, we called them, in 90s, we called them the Red Directors. Red Directors was a huge force in society. That was that part of the Soviet nomenclature, which was not satisfied with the radical neoliberal transformation. If you are the chief of the Communist Party somewhere in Tomsk, then you just lose your power and your influence in one day, but you still know all chiefs and directors of the big enterprises. And if you are a director of the huge industrial factory somewhere in province, then you will be not satisfied with the shock therapy and economic policy, which led to the collapse of industry. And Red Directors demand not the return to the planned economy. They demand just, let's say, Chinese version of reforms with the support of industry by the state. They demand tax incentives. I'm not sure that I say that word correctly. Tax incentives and dotations to the factories. But those real interest was collaboration with authorities, with collaboration with power, not the permanent conflict. That's why they does not try to repeat mobilization on the street or in factories, but they put all accents into the parliamentary struggle. Those ideal was not the socialist as a social system. Those interest was a huge industrial power, and those main images was China and the Stalin industrialization. Look, used they to say, neoliberals destroyed the plants and factories, and Stalin was the one who created them. Thus, Stalin became one of the icons of that interpretation of communism. To understand the level of those flexibility, you can listen to the speech of Gennady Zyuganov in the February 1996 in Davos. President Yeltsin had just 5% of rating, and all the world recognized Zyuganov as a next Russian president. So he went to the main capitalistic forum in Davos, and then there he promised to be flexible and clever to international investors. We will make the bland economy, we will recognize the private property, said he, and we would be very welcome to the West investors. At the same time, Red directors were really scared in front of the concurrence with the transnational corporations and the Western capital. As a solution, as a in ideological level, that fear transformed to the economical and then cultural nationalism. Thus, they created other side of red and brown ideology. Then nationalism and cultural conservatism played for them the same role indeed, which identity politics played for the former European communists. Cultural practices camouflating the social defeat and the abandoning of the radical social program in the name of new ethic agenda. In the social level, they still demand to restore the Soviet level of the social guarantees. We will restore the social contract of 80s, use they to promise. And that kind of social conservatism was not the monopoly of the Communist Party. For example, Andrei Isaev, the charismatic leader of the anarchist movement in perestroika and early 90s time, he made a career as a trade union's ideologist, chief editor of the main labor newspaper. And in 1994, he published a program article where he wrote that now left should transform from revolutionaries to the conservatives, just because of all social guarantees which socialists fight and revolutionaries fight before, now is already conquered, and now we should just defend them from the right forces. And ideas, the war clean ideology of retreat. But it doesn't mean that they were unsuccessful. They were quite successful. Zyuganov, 1996, probably won the election, but recognized the victory of his own opponent. Even Dmitry Medvedev, who served as a president of Russian Federation from 2008-2012, he said in the meeting with not parliamentary parties that we all knew who won the election of 1996, and it was not Boris Nikolaevich Yeltsin. But instead of president power, Gennady Zyuganov got quite big influence. He got the biggest parliamentary fraction in State Duma. He got around half of the governor places. The half of Russian regions were led by the communist politicians. Finally, 1998, after the Russian economy collapsed once again, the Communist Party formed the central left government, which made some reforms and create all that rise of economy which Vladimir Putin inherited from them in 2000s. And let's go to our national leader. Indeed, it was quite easy equation. Putin just symbolically finished all what already happened in the late 90s. Here, I'm coming to the end, Rosen. he integrated the red directors into the ruling class. The former red governors, for example, in mass just went to the new governmental party, the United Russia, and still sitting there. Putin refused from the liberal rhetorics in the name of the abstract patriotism. He restored the music of the Soviet hymn, national song, and recognized the Soviet flag as a legitimate national symbol, as a victory's flag. From the middle of 2000, he started to use anti-Western rhetorics, where he described his politics as a continuation of the internal confrontation with the colonial ambitions, against the colonial ambitions of the West. And he called the USSR collapse as the greatest geopolitical catastrophe. Finally, thanks to the oil prosperity of 2000s, Putin proposed the kind of social contract. He is a minimum of the social guarantees in exchange of full loyalty and depolitization. So in some way, Putin was the main keeper of the red and brown heritage. And I have just two points more. In the last decade, it was a new dialectical turn of the history. Still, governmental propaganda, use all the symbols of the Soviet past and describe the Soviet past as our imperial past, the tradition of the internal Russian national statehood. The people in the down of society start to find new aspects in that patriotic and Soviet rhetoric. You know, when we last year looked how the New York Times with its Project 1619 fight against Donald Trump's Commission 76, we felt nostalgia because we have the same memory politics just 10 years ago. It was a moment when the ruling class splitted and there was an informal party inside the ruling class which wanted to keep Dmitry Medvedev as a more liberal president in power in order to create peace with the West, with West countries. And in order to solve that discussion, authorities start a huge discussion about history in TV. All TV channels start a historical show where they discussed history. Was Stalin good or bad? Was repressions of 1937 necessary or not? Was it the crime or not? And so on. Was the victims, the amount of victims in war necessary or not? And in all that discussions, people could vote for one of position. There were two sides, the liberal one. For them, Soviet Union is just prisons of is just prison of peoples, the empire of evil, and the Soviet patriotic speakers. And all the time, between 75% and 85% of TV audience voted for Soviet patriotism. And the last decade was the rise of the Stalin's popularity. If Vladimir Putin would lose election to someone, it would be Joseph Stalin. Here you see the results of polls in different years, how Stalin's popularity grew up. But there was a surprise. There was a surprise because if governmental propaganda saw Stalin as a national leader, as a traditional authoritarian leader, together with all that line of tsars from the Ivan the Terrible, then for people, much more important Stalin as a symbol of social equality. For people, Stalin even important as a person who threatened the elite, who shot at half of the party's nomenclature. So he recognized in a way how Western Maoists in 60s and 70s recognized the Cultural Revolution in China as a authoritarianism, as a symbol of democratical hopes. And then we came to the year 2021. As all nations in the whole world, Russians during 2010s became more left. And that turn to the left forced Putin to use more and more Soviet nostalgia, more and more social populism in his rhetoric. It forced the liberal opposition, Alexei Navalny, for example, to use it as their own words, to recognize the Soviet past not as a prison of the peoples, but as our own national past. But at the same time, change the very nature of that leftism, that low disappointing in the governmental social politics create the request for their own political representation. Their old model, that classic red and brown model, where justice and freedom opposed to each other and democracy was a dirty word, now is changing to the gradually changing to the kind of social democratic agenda where freedom and justice complement each other. Russian specificity is that the social democratic or democratical socialist agenda could be expressed through the Stalin's portrait, through that symbolic heritage of the red and brown culture. And as a final point, I want to just describe two important examples. At least one is important. You know, the biggest social movement now in Russia is a quite funny movement which calls themselves citizens of the USSR. In many ways, they are very similar to the American canon, but not right one. They are left one. Those symbolic lines, those iconography is very communist. They believe that Soviet Union is still exists. And if we have some fake, the fake is contemporary Russian Federation. Just because of such level of inequality and injustice could not be truth. And Soviet citizens is hundreds and hundreds, thousands of people, and probably millions of people. They are printing Soviet passes of Soviet style. They create the whole hierarchy of Soviets in every region, and executive committees and prosecution, and preparing to the moment when all the nation just open eyes and recognize the truth that we are still living in the parallel world, in the country of the social justice, which called the Union of the Soviet Socialist Republic. And the last one picture, you know, a week ago, as a journalist, I wrote a reportage. It was dedicated to, I guess it was one of the most successful in my career. It was a reportage dedicated to the BDSM Stalinist swinger club. It makes very strong impression. So before the swing orgy, people are sitting and with very serious face discussing the class inequality and the necessity of the revolutionary tribunal against the people's enemy on the top. I mean, you know, social revolution, not social, sexual revolution did not transform the worldwide of the people in the deep level. They just integrate sexual freedom in those original, deep, worldwide. In USSR and in red and brown movement of 90s, the free sexual attitude reflects as a Western diversion, you know, almost imperialistic attack against the Soviet Union and Soviet power. But members of that BDSM Stalin swing club want to build not Europe and not the United States and not the correct capitalism. They want to build Union of Soviet Socialist Republic version 2, just with blackjack and hookers, as one cartoon character used to say. That's probably all.
Thank you, Alexei. Thank you for this really very powerful excursion through the fortunes of the Red-Brown movement. Now is the time for the audience to ask questions, and if you can ask them through the chat, we can also have people speak out their questions, but maybe we can start with the chat first. You know, please feel free to post your questions there, but I'll speak them out. And maybe as questions are accumulating, maybe I can ask Alexei a somewhat provocative question, which probably you answered for the most part. To what extent is this Red-Brown movement, you know, which, you know, emerged as a force in the 90s and has subsequently declined, or more specifically been transformed into something else, but still something not exactly left, something with a good deal of brownish characteristics. And so my question is, to what extent this loose force can be articulated and appropriated for the left? And probably, you know, suspecting your answer, exactly what then is to be done with all these brownish characteristics they still have, with the residual imperialism, with the Russian nationalism, with the homophobia, which, despite your last example, is probably still there. How can one work with them politically and help articulate a purer left, as it were? So yes, if you could answer this question, you know, we will have others through the chat.
If I understand your question correct, then, you know, all that, the most part of that brown aspects, as I tried to show in the last paragraph of my report, my piece, all that brown aspect is almost over. What is still here is a passivity, is a deficit of participation. And I guess that growing of political participation would clean the left movement and the people's and the public culture in the country from the rest of the brown aspects of that heritage from 90s. I mean, the main subject which return us into that brown nationalistic agenda in the left field is the Communist Party. And at the same time, it's the same force which blocks the autonomous activities of masses, which all the time try to keep that activities in the framework of their parliamentary ambitions. As far as we would be able to cross that border, as far as we would be able to mobilize people on the social issues, social demands, you would not see any brown detail in that movement.
Wonderful.
So mobilization. Mobilization is the answer.
Wonderful. So I see, I saw a question from Stanimir Panayotov, who's raised his hand, but temporarily I've lost.
Looks him. Like he just left the meeting, but re-entered. Stanimir, I can go ahead and unmute you if you're ready to ask the question.
Thanks, Sasha.
No problem.
Yes, I'm ready. Can you hear me?
Yes.
Yeah, I'm sorry. I had to re-enter because I lost your audio for a while. I don't know why. Right. Hi. Thank you. I don't know if you can see me and hear me well. This is very interesting. It's the second time I'm delving into this topic. I think the Russian example is mind-blowing on so many levels. One thing that I'm particularly interested in, it's just a question that involves a little bit of comparison. And since I see you are based in the US, I was wondering whether the red-brown alliances that are occurring for the last 30 years in the post-Soviet space, so not just Russia probably, but post-Soviet space construed more broadly, can be in some strange way compared to the strategy of fusionism in American politics. Fusionism, the politics of fusionism. In other words, I thought fusionism is a... Do I need to explain this a little bit? Or?
Yes, please. I don't know.
What okay. Sorry. So fusionism is just this kickoff philosophy of the American right wing after Roosevelt, broadly speaking, with the establishment of intellectual circles that are basically trying to splice together traditionalism, social conservatism, and a form of right-wing libertarianism, so not the left type of libertarianism. So as a result, the fusionism in American politics and American political philosophy has different iterations, but one way in which this has been happening recently is that it went kind of on the left, because some people, for example, in the Trump intellectual orbit, as much as there is such a thing, actually identify us with the original fusion strategy of fusionism, but tend to side with the working class in a way that Trump even himself doesn't do that. So that was my question, but I apologize if that doesn't sound familiar or relevant to you, because I just thought that this is something we can discuss, yes. But, yeah.
I'm just not this much competent in fusionism as American traditional intellectual or social tradition. I want just to say that in Russian case, you know, the national tradition is very left itself, just because of Soviet past. So many parallels we can see, of course, between the citizens of USSR and canon. but still canon are obviously right-wing subculture, and Soviet citizens are not, probably, if to answer briefly.
Great. So we have two questions on the chat, both dealing with Ukraine. And the first one is by Mary Kawina. I'll read them together because you can address them as a group. Mary Kawina, can you speak about how Russian adventurism in Eastern Ukraine and Crimea fits into this perspective? And then Natalia Savelyeva. Hi, Natasha, even though I probably mispronounced your name. Can you elaborate how this ideology and people who support it contributed to the Donbas war? There were people, leftist nationalist activists from Russia among them, who joined the anti-Kiev armed groups, many local people who supported anti-Kiev movement, also supported, many local people who supported the anti-Kiev movement also supported a slight mistake. I'm in particularly interested to hear if you have any knowledge about it, what happened to leftist nationalist circles in Russia in 2014 that facilitated mobilization for joining the anti-Kiev movement and armed groups.
It's, I guess, both of them are very relevant questions. Let's start from Donbas. One journalist called the war in the Eastern Ukraine the Soviet anti-Soviet war. And I guess it is very deep and wide understanding. Donbas, that eastern region in Ukraine, is one of the most industrialized steel territories in post-USSR. And it is one of the original centers for that type of worldwide and public culture. So of course their Soviet values were very popular. It's very mixed in ethnical sense area, and when half of the people are ethnically Russians living in Ukraine and other half are ethnically Ukrainians, but speaking only Russians, only Russian in everyday life, it would be very difficult to create identity, national identity with in framework of that, national mythology, which post-Maidan authorities tried to do in Ukraine. So of course that Soviet nostalgia and the red brownism was a spontaneous ideology of the resistance of the anti-Maidan movement in the Eastern Ukraine, not only in Donbas, but as well in Odessa and Kharkov and other cities. And there, before Asen asked me about what to do with the brown aspect of red and brown tradition. And there in Donbas and in Eastern European movements, protest movement, we saw that the brown nationalistic aspect not disappeared, but minimalized. And the main issues was the social issues. Then of course, all that Ukrainian tragedy for a few years became the main question of the Russian internal agenda. And they led to the government and governmental propaganda to speculate on the question which have the real essence for millions of people. They're like 40% of Russians have relatives in Ukraine and half of Ukrainians have relatives in Russia. Something like this. So people were quite well informed what is going on in Ukraine and informed mostly from side of Eastern Ukrainians, so-called pro-Russian territories. So that was a case where their engagement, not objectivity of Western media and liberal media in Russia became too obviously, became too clean, and just discreditate all that liberal pro-Western forms of critique of Putin regime. So around Crimea and Ukrainian war, Kremlin created the hugest social coalition during the all last 30 years. So between 2014 and 2018, there were even kind of ideological cliche, the 86%. The 86% was a majority who support Russian government in its politics in Eastern Ukraine. I would say that majority never existed in many ways, because inside that majority was different streams, different groups with a different agenda. We can discuss it if you want separately. But all that national consensus, it forced Kremlin to refuse from the most shameful nationalistic rhetoric. If you will take a look how Russian propaganda looks between 2012 and 2014, it was very brown. It described the labor migrants as parasites in a healthy body. And then when far rights played a huge role in Ukrainian events, in Ukrainian catastrophe, then the criticism of far rights became the natural issue, became the natural argument for Kremlin media, for pro-Kremlin propaganda. And that new form of much more left patriotism, that kind of anti-imperialist, anti-colonial imperialist, collect a lot of sympathies around Kremlin. And for 4 years, Putin's support was a really huge, and there was no way to challenge it. Just when Putin returned again in 2018, and when he made the antisocial reform that raised the pension older, the retirement age, then that huge electoral majority started to crash, started to disappear slowly. But yes, Ukraine gave them a huge argumentation. An argumentation from the box of Soviet patriotism.
Great. So we have one more question by Peter Heng, and probably that would be the last one. So the question is precisely in the direction that you've been moving towards. For how long will the current ruling classes in Russia, I assume, be able to appropriate the Soviet heritage? The appropriation tactic may be effective, but the move is also connected to the need and desperation of the ruling classes.
They will try as long as they can. But as I tried to show in the last part of my report, even official propaganda of patriotism and the Soviet nostalgia and the Soviet values make an ironic joke with the propagandists. If they, our ruling class, try to appropriate the Soviet past, then people downstairs, the poor majority, the working class, try to appropriate main symbols and icons of that propaganda and interpret it against that propaganda in offensive level. Like I tried to show with Stalin. official cinema, official film industry and television interpretate Stalin, show Stalin as a like traditional Tsar, the authoritarian leader who fight the West and keep the strong order and destroyed all form of opposition. And it does not play any role in a public opinion. Nobody discusses that stuff. When people are discussing Stalin, we see it in many sociological research, in many sociological polls, that when people discuss Stalin, they evaluate him as a threat against elite, as a person who was a revolutionary fighting against Tsarist elite, and then the leader who shoot the corrupted, privileged top of the party. And then they are looking, they see Stalin as a symbol of social justice. You know, some months ago, I wrote an article about the coffee culture in Moscow. And I took few interviews from very elitarian coffee net. And one of my interviews was with a guy who have a very small and cheap coffee shop in Moscow suburb, who live on like, I don't know, $400 per month. And still he's formerly small bourgeoisie, as a classic Marxist would call him. And he finished interview with such words. You know, that's why I wissh Иосиф Виссарионович Сталин done with consumption. Let it be just bread on my table. Let it be just one bread on my table, but it would be social justice, motherfucker. It was very emotional speech, which shows how that soft Stalinist propaganda, that governmental propagandistic flirt with Stalinism, with Soviet nostalgia, transforms in the eyes and in the heads of people downstairs.
Fantastic. So we have two more questions that have just come up, and one of them actually does have to do with the figure of the leader, but not Stalin. And Tom Somerville asks about Lenin. I mean, you've wonderfully discussed the image of Stalin, not, you know, it's necessarily implying a love of Gulag and of the political system called Stalinism, but rather it's a, you know, it's a very strange symbol of social justice. But here Tom Somerville asks, why does Lenin feature in the ideology, writing, and culture of the movement?
Okay, we discussed, first of all, Stalin, because Stalin is an icon of the red and brown movement. If you remember the first slide of my presentation, it was icon of Stalin. And it's not an exotic joke. You would see them a lot in communist demonstrations. So here is it. So Stalin was not an occasional character in that narrative. Not because of I am a fan of Stalin, just because of he is a symbol of that phenomenon. And what about Lenin? Lenin is partly forgotten figure in the current political discussion, political culture in Russia. There is no any active subject which is ready to discuss Lenin, neither authorities. For example, it's always exist question is to захоронить Ленина.
Burying Lenin.
Is to reburying Lenin, you know, from mausoleum in the Red Square to some cemetery. And authorities' position is let he be there. We don't want to provoke the conflict inside the society in such question and provoke the discontent in society on the empty place. So nobody discussed Lenin from authority side. The Communist Party doesn't touch, discuss Lenin just as a ritual figure. They much more concentrated on Joseph Stalin figure. But a few years ago, I remember, I forgot which year was it, but it was like 17 or 16. There was a huge, there was a kind of a TV referendum when millions of people, it called the name of Russia, the name of Russia. So everyone can call and for 10 rubles vote whom he supposes is the most important historical figure. And TV managers, they forced some medieval princes, Alexander Nevsky or something like that. But the first place objectively took Joseph Stalin, and the second place suddenly took Lenin. The distance was quite big. Then they just falsificate voices and put Nicholas II in the first place. But it was so shameful lies that everybody recognized it. There was many articles and research and investigations about that. But that first days when a few millions of people voted, first was Stalin and second suddenly was Lenin. So I think Lenin will not disappear from the historical memory of the people.
Wonderful. And so we have a question from Lucian George, maybe our last question. In East Central Europe, post-socialist nostalgia is often most successfully channeled not by the left, but by forces of the populist right, which are declaratively anti-communist. I'm thinking of Viktor Orban and Kaczynski as the prototypical examples of this. Why do you think the same decommunization of post-communist nostalgia hasn't happened in Russia? Is it just because the communist state was never perceived as alien?
Because of many reasons. First of all, as I also tried to show, in Russia, the social catastrophe happened together with a national catastrophe, with the collapse of the state, which were recognized as our state. So collapse of welfare state happened during 1 month, the same month when the first month after the Soviet Union collapsed. So that type of in Eastern Europe, in Eastern European countries, nationalists recognize the round tables and the anti-communist transformation as a liberation. That create a totally different trajectory of the ideological evolution. Then, second reason, the Communist Party integrate that national conservatism in its propaganda very early. And then Putin regime just takes that heritage and appropriates that heritage. So it Putin regime, you can see in context of Orban and Polish conservators as a kind of Bonapartist social populist regime, which mixed neoliberal politics with social populism in some way and nationalistic patriotic rhetoric. And finally, the third part of the answer is now, a bit later, but we also have that kind of anti-communist reaction. In liberal opposition, it's quite big flank side.
Oh, yes.
Unite around the group or movement call themselves decommunization. And those like answer on the social and the political crisis coming crisis in Russia is that Russia is still communist country. The problem is that we did not made the repressive decommunization with the punishment for all communists, both in the top and down. So that form of reactionary anti-communism, right-wing anti-communism is here. It's not this much powerful, but in case of possible victory of the liberal opposition in some coalition with ruling class, ruling elite, that could be used as it used in Ukraine.
Great. Fantastic. So I think this is a good place to end. I'd like to thank all of you who stayed with us. I'd like to thank Alexei for giving us this education and history.
Thank you all. And I'm sorry for my very poor and limited English.